The other concept that is of extreme importance as far as SEM is concerned is the presence, not all the time, of a X-ray detector. Now, in most SEMs, you will only have the secondary detector. The basic SEMs will have only secondary detector. If you are willing to pay a certain extra price over it, you will be able to get the backscatter detector, right? But you also have to sometimes invest in the EDS or EDX detector. So, sometimes it is called EDX, sometimes it is called EDS, energy dispersive X-ray analysis or energy dispersive spectroscopy. Now, sometimes people wrongly call it as EDAX. EDAX is the name of a commercial product for EDS. Okay, so technically when you write your papers and describe this process in your papers, you cannot be calling it as EDAX. EDAX is actually a commercial name. So, the actual scientific name is EDX or EDS. So, what is happening here? We know that the electron beam is now striking your sample, and we said that secondary electrons are basically the outer shell electrons that are getting dislodged, low energy electrons which are collected by the secondary detector. We have the backscattered electrons which are going straight up and collected by the annular detector or annular ring which is placed around the objective lens. Okay. Now, again, what is the difference between secondary and backscattered electrons? Secondary electrons are electrons from the atoms in the sample. Backscattered electrons are the same electrons as the incident electrons which are going back. Okay. Now, what is happening is these incident electrons obviously of high energy, and when you have a high energy, you can also knock off the inner shell electrons of the sample. If you have a sample atom, let us say silicon or calcium present, these electrons are high enough energy that they go and knock off the inner shell electrons. So, what happens here is quite similar to what happens in the process of generation of X-rays in the X-ray tube. So, instead of X-rays being the external simulation, in this case the external simulation is done by the high energy electrons. So, they are now dislodging the inner shell electrons. So, what will happen now is an electron from the outer shell will try to jump in. So, just like what is shown here, an electron from the next higher shell will now try to jump in. Okay. When it jumps in, there is an energy difference which is released as heat and as X-rays. Okay. So, radiation is basically composed of heat as well as X-rays. So, these X-rays are characteristic because they define a very clear energy transition. For example, here from the L shell to the K shell. You can also have M to K, but the possibility of that happening is much lower than L to K. So, that is why whenever you look at X-ray intensities that are generated from the target metal in an X-ray tube, you see you generate a larger intensity of the K alpha and K beta as opposed to L alpha, L beta, right. So, here we are talking about characteristic X-rays which are generated from the atoms in the sample, much like what we talked earlier about X-ray fluorescence. X-ray fluorescence is practically the same thing. Instead of the electron beam that we have here, the external stimulation is by X-rays. So, actually truly speaking, what happens inside your X-ray tube in the X-ray generation device is nothing but X-ray fluorescence, right. But there again, the external stimulation is your high energy electrons which are accelerated through the potential difference. They hit the target metal and generate the metals, the target metals X-rays. If it is copper, we generate copper X-rays, cobalt, we generate cobalt X-rays, and so on and so forth. So, here energy dispersive spectroscopy is related to the detection of the X-rays that get fluoresced from the atoms in the sample as a result of interaction with the electron beam. So, if you have an X-ray detector, energy dispersive X-ray detector, it will now collect all the X-rays that are coming from different elements in the sample. If you have cement, obviously you will get everything from calcium, silicon, iron, magnesium, sodium, potassium, everything you will be able to collect and display that in a plot between the intensity and the energy. Energy typically will be in kilo electron volts. Okay. So, what you will get is plots like this. So, each one of these peaks will correspond to a specific element, to a specific element. Yeah. Accelerating voltage for a very dense material, you may not be able to generate sufficient energy to have these inertial transitions taking place. But in all cases, when you select the right level of accelerating voltage with a high energy electron beam, you will be able to generate X-rays from the sample, definitely.
So, this works on inelastic
scattering. Yeah. So, scattering, we are talking about the scattering of the incoming radiation. Whenever we talk about scattering, it is the incoming radiation that is getting scattered in different directions. So, here that this is fluorescence, this is the electrons in the sample atom which are undergoing transitions producing X-rays. Okay, so, this is X-ray fluorescence from the sample. So, very important to understand is you need a high working voltage to get a good EDX signal, right. Again, the same effects will happen in this case also. You need a shorter working distance. Why do you need a shorter working distance? Because again, you can focus with a very strong current and there you will be able to generate the X-rays. But there is a practical difficulty. If I am able to go back to the, yeah. So, there is a practical difficulty. What happens often is when your working distance is very low, when your working distance is small, okay, if your sample is, let us say here, it is generating these backscattered electrons, it is generating the X-rays which have to go towards the EDS detector. So, very often if the short working distance is there, which is required for a good quality collection of X-rays, what will happen is many of these X-rays that are going will get blocked by your backscattered electron detector. It may actually happen to be in the path, it may just not let your X-rays to go towards the detector. So, very often what you may have to do is take a backscattered image for the area that you are interested in, but then remove your detector so that it does not come in the path of your X-rays that are going towards the X-ray detector. Very often when you actually do the X-ray SEM analysis, that is what your technician will tell you to do. To collect better X-rays, you may have to move the backscattered detector out of the path. Otherwise, very often the backscattered detector tends to block the path of the X-rays. Because you are working at a low working distance. If your working distance is high, definitely these X-rays will be able to go quite easily to the X-ray detector. You will not have a problem with blockage. But then to get large number of X-rays, you need to reduce the working distance. Okay. Right. So, obviously, as I said earlier, energy levels depend on the atomic number. So, what you will get is a plot between the intensity or the number of X-rays that are collected for a specific level of energy. Okay, so, this is energy plotted here in electron volts. So, one example is given here, where you have a calcium silicate system like a CSH for instance. If you look at the energy dispersive spectroscopy pattern for CSH, you will see calcium. There are two peaks for calcium. Why do you think that happens? Because you are getting calcium K alpha and K beta. You are getting both K alpha and K beta. What is K alpha? When the transition happens from L to K. Beta is when transition happens from M to K. So, the probability of alpha transitions are much more than beta transitions. So, you get a higher intensity of alpha radiation and lower intensity of beta radiation. You have silicon here. You do not really see the secondary peaks of silicon. You only see the primary K alpha peak. You have aluminium, you have some sulfur. Okay. So, what you can do is once you actually collect the signal, X-ray signal, you can turn off and on the kind of elements that you want. So, that means that you need to have a prior idea of what you think should be there in the system. That is not too difficult. No? If you are working with cementitious systems, you know that you need to have calcium, right? Where is calcium now? Calcium, you need to have probably sometimes magnesium, sodium, potassium. Need to have silicon, right? There may be carbon. However, carbon produces your lowest energy level X-rays. So, very often people do not rely on EDS to detect carbon. However, you can detect carbon because the carbon peaks will appear. For example, if you are looking at a phase like calcium carbonate, you will be able to see calcium, oxygen and carbon. So, the second peak is oxygen, the first peak is carbon. Okay. So, you will be able to see that. So, generally we also select carbon, oxygen. What else will you select? Iron, You will select iron, okay, iron is here. Aluminium, where is aluminium now? Okay, yeah, here. Probably sulfur. If you are looking at a chloride contaminated sample, you may have chloride phases, may be able to detect chloride also. It is very rare that you will have anything else apart from these, right? We have covered all the major elemental species that are likely to be in your cement, okay. But the issue is, without knowing what is actually there in your sample, you cannot really make a good judgment about it. Then you will have to rely on the auto detect capabilities of your software, and the software may actually end up detecting unnecessary elements which may or may not be there. Sometimes what happens is in this process is that you may also kind of detect the coating. In some cases you may be also able to detect the coating. If your coating thickness is too large, like gold palladium coating, if you are putting on top, if your coating thickness is large, you will also get the X-rays from the coating. So you will also produce gold in some cases, okay, you may also produce peaks for gold. So that may confuse your spectrum quite a bit. But anyway, you need to be aware of what you need to select to do an analysis, because the same elemental composition that you get from the energy dispersive spectroscopy can be quantified, okay. I am not going to this process of quantification, but there are methodologies to actually quantify this, to actually get a good elemental level composition of your sample. And this composition is typically presented in terms of weight percentage. It can also be presented in terms of atomic percentage. Now, what do you mean by weight percentage and atomic percentage? Supposing you take calcium carbonate, okay, calcium carbonate. So the total molecular weight of calcium carbonate is 100, okay. Calcium itself is, what is the weight of calcium? Sorry, yeah, 40. Atomic number is 20, atomic weight is 40 for calcium. Oxygen atomic weight is 16 and carbon atomic weight is 12, right. So what is the weight percentage of calcium in calcium carbonate? 40%, right, 40 divided by 100, so 40%. So if you take a pure calcium carbonate and do an energy dispersive spectroscopy on it, you will get a weight percentage of 40% for calcium. However, if you want to do the atomic percentage, it is basically the proportion of the calcium atoms in the structure of CaCO3. So how many atoms totally are there in CaCO3? Ca, carbon and 3 oxygen, so 5, you have 5 atoms. So what is the atomic percentage of calcium? 1 divided by 5, that is 20%. So while the weight fraction is 40%, the atomic fraction is 20%. So that is what is presented in this case, weight fraction and atomic fraction. Now let us say you are looking at C3S. C3S is 3CaOSiO2. So if you do EDX of this, what will be your atomic fraction of calcium? 3 by 7. So Ca will be 3 by 7 into 100 if you convert to percentage, of course. Ca is 3/7. Oxygen is 5/7. Sorry, what, 7? No, 3 plus 3, 6 plus 1, 7 plus 2, 9. 3 by 9. Calcium is 3 by 9. Oxygen is 5 by 9. Silicon is 1 by 9. So, if you do an energy dispersive spectroscopy on C3S phase, right, what should be your approximate height difference, or rather percentage height between calcium and silicon? Ca by Si should be how much? 3 by 1 or nearly 3, okay, that is what you will see typically in most X-ray patterns, right. However, of course, it's not the exact thing. What you will see here in the intensity is more likely to be corresponding to the weight fractions and not to the atomic fractions. But when you do a elemental analysis from the surface and you resolve the weight and atomic fractions, from this you can actually start calculating what is the likely composition of the phase that you are observing. For example, here your calcium is 56.69, silicon is 31, you do not really have too much aluminium, let us say you have a little bit of aluminium, okay. Sodium is there, you have some sulfur, okay. All these could be just incorporated in the structure of the calcium silicate itself, okay, and you have a little bit of iron. And typical methodology of doing this quantification is called the ZAF methodology. Again, we do not have time to go into that in detail, but in reality what we are seeing is when you have C3S, the atomic percentage of calcium to silicon will be about 3. If you look at CSH, the atomic fraction or rather the elemental fraction of calcium to silicon will be in the range of 1.2 to 2.2. We know that CSH, typical CSH produced by ordinary potent cement hydration, has a calcium to silicon ratio of about 1.5 to 2. When you replace cement with fly ash or slag or silica fume, you tend to reduce the calcium to silica ratio towards 1.5 or less than that, okay. So you have weight proportions and atomic proportions. So you need to be careful about selecting the right one to depict your actual composition of the sample. Again, you will see some examples later on. And quantification is done in XRD in that way, but here it is a little bit different. It is not the same as taking the area under the curve. We take the relative intensities and use that as a measure of what you will actually get based on the atomic weight of the sample. So there are some corrections to be applied in this case. The weight and atomic fraction is calculated by the software based on the ZAF corrections, but you have to interpret what this material is. In the case of X-rays, it is not like that. X-rays, what you do is you compare your peaks or location of the peaks with the standard database. Here there is nothing like that. You do not have a standard database as far as energy dispersive spectroscopy is concerned. All you have a database of is where exactly will you get the intensity lines of different elements. You do not have database of different materials that will produce certain intensities in your sample. You need to collect that for yourself and look at the data yourself. We will see later how this data is actually plotted to make certain characteristic decisions about the type of phases that you are observing, okay. So, we will see how you need to represent this data. So, this weight fractions and atomic fractions need to be represented carefully when you actually want to do the analysis about the kind of phase that you are observing. Now, based on this atomic composition that has been presented here, what do you think would be the approximate composition of this material? What is this material that we are looking at? What is this phase for which the atomic composition is presented, you think?
CSH.
Probably CSH, yeah? Calcium silicate hydrate, because in calcium silicate hydrate you have alumina also incorporated with the silicon, you have alkalis that are adsorbed into the CSH, you may also have sulfur based upon the kind of temperatures that are there during the hydration process. So this phase composition is for CSH. Okay, calcium silicate hydrate. Now, what is the calcium to silica ratio here in this CSH? 56 divided by 31, okay, atomic fraction of calcium divided by atomic fraction of silicon. So, that is 56 by 31, that is approximately about 1.8 or so, 1.7 or 1.8, okay. But in terms of weight fraction, it is 64 divided by 25, so it is around 2.5, 2.6, like that, okay. But atomic fraction is 1.7 or 1.8, right. So, you need to convert the right numbers to assess the type of phase that you are actually looking at. So, if you make a decision based on weight fraction, this may appear to be something like a unhydrated phase, right, because calcium to silicon is so high, but the true calculation should be done with the atomic fraction. So, if you are looking at C3S, if you are looking at plain C3S, your atomic fraction should be 3 divided by 1, right, 3 is to 1. So, you should get 3 as your ratio of calcium to silicon in the case of C3S, but this is CSH, okay. So, I think we are out of time for today. We will talk about some practical difficulties on the how EDS is collected and what we are actually looking at as far as the EDS pattern is concerned.